The scripture for today's message is Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 33 through 38. Thus says the Lord God, on the day I cleanse you from all your iniquities, I will cause the cities to be inhabited, and the waste places will be rebuilt. The desolate land will be cultivated instead of being a desolation in the sight of everyone who passes by. They will say, this desolate land has become like the Garden of Eden, and the waste, desolate, and ruined cities are fortified and inhabited. Then the nations that are left around about you will know that I, the Lord, have rebuilt the ruined places and planted that which was desolate. I, the Lord, have spoken and will do it. Thus says the Lord God, this also I will let the house of Israel ask me to do for them. I will increase their men like the flock for sacrifices, like the flock at Jerusalem during her appointed feasts. So will the waste cities be filled with flocks of men. Then they will know that I am the Lord. Amen.
당회장 직무대행이신
On behalf of Senior Pastor, Acting Senior Pastor, Pastor Soo-jin Lee were delivered a message entitled, I will do it, but they will have to ask. I thank Deacon Soo-hyun Jung for your special praise. Let me introduce the flower offering. We give thanks and glory to Father God for protecting us in the space of the shepherd in this world, leading us to receive blessing of prosperity and helping us worship Him happily. We are also grateful to our loving shepherd for hovering us and leading us with the word and prayer until we meet this 9th anniversary. We all could become one in love by acting in the truth as we learned from the shepherd, and many families could fulfill their evangelization. Waiting for the day when we will meet the shepherd again, we hope to become the beautiful and best fruit of the shepherd by running in the fullness of the Holy Spirit with the hope for New Jerusalem. We offer up this flower offering, hoping that all mommy members in the world may receive answers and blessings through the word, through the vow prayer meeting starting from March 15th. We thank Acting Senior Pastor Dr. Soo-jin Lee and Mrs. Bong Yim Lee for hovering and praying for us. Thank you.
사랑하는 성도 여러분,
dear brothers and sisters, an old mother had three lazy sons, and she neared her death. She called her three sons and left a last will, saying, I've hidden some treasure under the field. Go and dig it out. Which means she was owning a field. After she passed away, to take the treasure, the three sons searched all of the field, all over. But no matter how deep they dug it, they couldn't discover it. As they had high expectations, they were greatly disappointed. But as the field had already been dug all over, they decided to spread fertilizer on it and take good care of it. And that autumn, each and every tree on the field bore abundant and beautiful fruit. They had already dug up the field deep, and as they add fertilizer and take good care of it, they had abundant fruit. Only then did they realize what the treasure was. If there had really been treasure under the field and they had dug it out, they would have become lazy and squandered it right away. Their mother's last will helped them cast off laziness and taught them the value of hard work, so we can say they obtained the best treasure. Like the mother who left the most valuable treasure for them, our Father God also wants to give us what is the best. But this doesn't mean God does so unconditionally. In today's passage, God tells us that He has spoken and will do it, but still we have to ask Him to do for us. I'll deliver the message based on Senior Pastor's sermon preached in June 1999. You know what happened in 1999? That was the year when the trial started. During that time, Senior Pastor delivered that message. May this message enlighten you on what we have to do to fulfill the covenants and promises God gave His beloved children. Briefly, let me explain the historical background of today's passage. Ezekiel is one of the books of the three major prophets. The writing of this book started around Judah's destruction, and it lasted during Jewish captivity in Babylon. Ezekiel was also taken captive during the Babylon's second attack on Judah. In 5 years after he was taken to Babylon, he was called to be a prophet by the river Chebar. God had Ezekiel prophesy his judgment on the northern and southern kingdoms, the fall of Jerusalem, and the judgment on the neighboring nations. According to Ezekiel's prophecy, the northern kingdom was destroyed by Assyria in 721 BC and the southern kingdom in 586 BC by Babylon that dominated the world after Assyria. The temple was destroyed with its vessels taken away, and many people, including high officials, were taken captive. The attack on Jerusalem and the destruction of the temple and their captivity indicates that God's name was greatly defiled by the Gentile nations. It wasn't just the destruction of Israel, but God's name, who led Israel, was defiled. Despite this situation, you know, Israel was destroyed, but God promised the restoration of Israel through prophet Ezekiel. Today's passage says, "Thus says the Lord, on the day that I cleanse you from all your iniquities, I will cause the cities to be inhabited, and the waste places will be rebuilt. The desolate land will be cultivated instead of being a desolation in the sight of everyone who passes by." The Israelites had been taken captive to Babylon, and there were only a few people remaining in the land, and the land had already been taken by the Gentiles, so the land had been desolate. But Father God prophesied that they will dwell in the land, and the moment, the time when they received that word was the time when they were captive. The land had already been desolate, and all the vessels of the temple had been taken away. In that painful moment, Father God promised restoration. Namely, on the day the sinful Israelites cleansed themselves by turning from all sins and evil, God would grant them amazing glory and blessings again. So, no question, this word of God must have given tremendous strength and hope to the Israelites who suffered all kinds of shame and afflictions, being held captives. By the way, God gave them such words of promise in order to declare to all nations that He would restore Israel, His glory and His holy name, which had been defiled. This can apply to ourselves as well. It wasn't just about the restoration of Israel, but through that restoration, God's glory will be restored, and that glory will be revealed to other nations as well. He said, "I will vindicate the holiness of my great name, which had been profaned among the nations, which you have profaned in their midst. Then the nations will know that I am the Lord, declares the Lord God, when I prove myself holy among you in their sight." The Israelites, whom God directly guided, people must have thought, The God who led you is dead. They could have said so. They could have mocked God like that. They could have mocked God as well as his people. But it all happened because Israel walked out of the way that didn't please God, so God couldn't help it. Father God wanted his name to be glorified, but he is glorified through his people, so God couldn't help it. That's why Father God rebuked them through the prophets, but the Israel didn't turn from their ways. But even though they suffered destruction, Father God promised restoration on the condition they turn from their ways. Father God prophesied, this is Father God's prophecy, and as the people accepted the word, Father God promised that if they turn from their ways, he would restore them and he would be glorified again. It was God's plan that he would be glorified through the restoration of Israel. Also, he intended for people to fear him from the bottom of their hearts. But we need to take note of the following words. I, the Lord, have spoken and will do it. Thus says the Lord. This also I will let the house of Israel ask me to do for them. This means that even though God has repeatedly promised to bless and answer us, still we have to ask for His answer, believing in His promise. Father God must have lamented. He wanted to give them. He had already planned to give them, but His people had to demonstrate these. Father God wanted to give them, but he told them to ask him. He had already prepared everything, so Father God exhorted them to ask him. You know, once God declares that he would do something, it is fulfilled for sure. But for this to become reality that we can see and touch, we first have to ask God. Even though God has declared that He would do something, we have to believe in and obey it. Believing in and obeying it, we would unceasingly ask until it is fulfilled. And it will be fulfilled just as He said. If we do nothing, merely thinking, because God promised to bless us, we have nothing to do, His answer wouldn't come. First, we need to believe in His promise, and if we believe, we would obey. Believing in God's answering us, we have to ask. Only then can His answer come. Why? Because the Lord said, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you. Even though God already has His answer in stock, it is by the law of the spiritual realm that we bring down His answer by asking, seeking, and knocking. Unless we seek, knock, and ask, it's not ours. With man's way of thinking, we may expect that things would happen anyhow because God has spoken, but actually, this is not waiting for His answer. It's not truly believing. So, this is not God's will. As He said, I, the Lord, have spoken and will do it. Thus says the Lord God, this also I will let the house of Israel ask me to do for them. Even though we've received God's word of promise, we have to continually ask Him on our part until it is fulfilled. Well, this can apply when we receive the special prayer of blessing at the New Year service or the vow prayer meeting we had recently. If we've received If we have received a prayer, God will surely give you a good measure. If you prayed according to what you've done and done, God will give you a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Still, you need to examine whether you truly believe in His answer to your prayer or my prayer. If you believe, whether you truly believe in His answer, if you believe, you'd obey according to the truth and continually ask without being discouraged until you actually receive it. Just because the vow prayer meeting period is over, you don't stop praying. Because you received the prayer, the only thing I can do is wait and see. Until you receive it, you have to continually ask. Believing in His promise, you have to pray. This is the law of the spiritual realm. Because you don't believe from your heart, you don't ask even after God says He would give. And because you don't have true faith in it, you stop praying. Well, during the vow prayer meeting period, you pray. And after that period is over, you, according to your free will, you just don't pray. This is not true faith. Spiritual faith. If you cannot understand the spiritual laws even while reading and hearing the Word of God, it's truly regrettable. If you don't really understand the principles of the receiving the answer, it's truly regrettable. If you read them like you read secular novels or good essays, it's no use. As you read the Bible, as you read the Word of God, you have to do it with the inspiration of the Spirit and discover the spiritual principles, spiritual laws, amidst the inspiration and the fullness of the Spirit, figure out God's heart and will, and do accordingly. Only then can you be answered and blessed. While senior pastor is away, did you pray with faith? If you truly pray with faith, you must have become joyful. And as time passed by, did you find your faith gone? And with your faith gone, you are filled with complaints, looking at the reality.
And
you know, you have to know that this church is set up by God, and the works are the works of God. It is impossible for man to do it. How could people be healed when I pray from the pulpit? How could people with paralyzed body can move around? Can a person become healthy just because he is in good, he is, paralyzed body, how could a paralyzed body be healed just because he is, how could dead nerves be revived? It cannot happen. It is not a coincidence. How could, this is the evidence of the living God, and it is the evidence of Father God being with us still, even while we cannot see the shepherd. As this time is delayed, some people, say, Father God is not, just because you cannot receive answer from God, Father God is not dead. He is still alive. Even if your prayer is not answered, Father God is still the master of the universe. Because just because you are not qualified, you cannot receive the answer, or just because the proper time has not arrived, you have not received. And you can just wait more to make your faith perfect. But why do some people live as if there were no God at all, and commit sins and build up more wall of sin? And because they cannot pray with faith, they, even after they pray, they shake off their prayer through the words of their lips. This should never happen with you. Father God clearly tells us He would give us, but we have to ask with faith and uniting as one. Just as He told Israelites, He is telling us the same way. Even if we have the Father God's promise, it is by the spiritual law that we have to ask. You know, the Israelites suffered destruction and their temple had been destroyed. Even so, Father God promised that the temple would be restored. And that promise, how could that promise be fulfilled? Israelites had to, through people who realized the spiritual law and prayed and hold on to God, His promise was fulfilled. Daniel was an example. Daniel understood well such spiritual principles. He was taken captive to Babylon in 605 BC during Babylon's first attack on Jerusalem. He was also a man of a royal, despite being a captive, he became the prime minister of the empire amidst God's grace. You know, everything was under God's plan. Due to the lack of time, I cannot go into greatest detail, but such significant individuals were under God's plan. Those people who prayed and asked God by faith. And Daniel, you know, I also urge you to become like Daniel. You know, Father God will fulfill things for my men, surely. You know, senior pastor delivered this message back in 1999. The church was in great difficulty back then. And during that time, senior pastor preached this message. And what happened after the trial? Father God blessed us with more. You know, back in 2000, He manifested His great work all over the world and the shepherd's power. And all our tears of the trial had been wiped away. All our sorrows had disappeared, and we restored very quickly. As you remember those times, we had such great hardship back in 1999. Without faith, it was such a toughest time. But with faith, it was, you know, but those who had faith could overcome that time, and according to their faith, Father God blessed us with great power. Think about that moment. Think, you know, the broadcasting incident. Due to the broadcasting incident, we suffered great trial, the judgment, and some unbelievers, when our church bus passed by, some of them even threw stones at us. We suffered such misunderstandings. Still, in such a short period of time, Father God restored everything. And what about this moment? We can overcome this moment. Remembering how Father God was glorified, and when Daniel discovered the word of God, he was joyful. And let me explain how he did. And I urge all Mami members to become like Daniel. But some people here still complain and try to hinder the work of God. And when Father God calculates everything, they cannot share in the joy and the glory of our Mamin. But those people who
모든 기도에 눈물의 씨앗이 되시기를 바랍니다. 자, 바벨론 다리오 왕 시대에 다니엘은 하나님께서 예레미야로
During the reign of King Darius, while Daniel was reading the book written by Prophet Jeremiah, you know, Prophet Jeremiah wrote the book of prophecy, and Daniel was reading the book by Prophet Jeremiah. He discovered a prophecy regarding the restoration of Israel, which said that all the desolation of Jerusalem would end in 70 years. It reads, "This whole land will be a desolation and a horror, and these nations will serve the king of Babylon 70 years. Then it will be when 70 years are completed, I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation, declares the Lord, for their iniquity and the land of the Chaldeans, and I will make it an everlasting desolation. I will bring upon the land all my words which I have pronounced against it, all that is written in the book which Jeremiah has prophesied against all the nations." Even before the fall of Israel, God already prophesied the restoration of Israel through prophet Jeremiah.
약속의 말씀을 주셨다고 했죠. 근데 그보다 전
It was before Israel suffered destruction when this word of God was given. Father God already prophesied the restoration. Namely, He notified the prophet in advance that Israel would serve the Babylonian king for the span of 70 years. How must Daniel have felt the moment he discovered this prophecy? Even though he was living in the royal palace in God's favor, most of the people were living as slaves in Babylon. So, this promise saying that the captivity would end in 70 years must have thrilled and excited him. Then, after discovering that covenant, do you think Daniel did nothing, merely thinking, "Wow, when the 70 years is up, we will go back to Jerusalem"? No, Daniel began to fast and pray, holding on to the word of God. It's not that God directly gave that word to Daniel. It was already spoken through Jeremiah dozens of years ago, and Daniel just read what was written in the book. But because Daniel believed the word as was, he fasted and prayed for its fulfillment. The Bible says, "So I gave my attention to the Lord God to seek Him by prayer and supplications, with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God and confessed and said, Alas, O Lord, the great and awesome God who keeps His covenant and loving kindness for those who love Him and keep His commandments." You know, in the Old Testament time, when people repented from their heart, they prayed in sackcloth and ashes. They put on sackcloth and they were in ashes for repentance. When Prophet Jonah proclaimed God's judgment on the city of Nineveh, people, even the Gentiles, prayed, fasted, and repented in sackcloth. The king commanded that all people and even animals be clothed in sackcloth. They, including the king himself, fasted without eating or drinking. God accepted the people's sincere deeds of repentance and their cry, and decided not to inflict the calamity on the city as He intended to. As people repented thoroughly from their heart, initially Father God planned to inflict calamity on them, but He decided not to. In the Old Testament time, people, you know, repented in sackcloth and ashes. But people don't repent in sackcloth and ashes in the New Testament time, because we are living in a time when the Holy Spirit dwells in our heart. As we rend our heart in repentance, God forgives us our sins and the Lord's blood cleanses us from all sins. So what we need to do is repent from the bottom of our heart. Daniel hung on to God, fasting in sackcloth and ashes for the fulfillment of God's covenant. For the fulfillment of Father God's blessing on Israelites. He hung on to God earnestly like that. He said, Alas, O Lord, the great and awesome God who keeps His covenant and loving kindness for those who love Him and keep His commandments.
그에게 인자를 베푸시는 이시여라고 고백합니다.
This is proper prayer according to the truth. In his prayer, Daniel called God the one who keeps his covenant and loving kindness for those who love him and keep his commandments, not just anyone. This is Daniel's confession. While we live in sins and evil and befriend the world and judge the world, if we say, Father, I love you, I believe that you will answer all my prayers, we are lying. His answer will never come. Because Daniel's prayer was so truthful and didn't deviate from the truth at all, God paid attention to his all his cries and answered and blessed him. Daniel lifted up God in his prayer and then he went on to repent on behalf of his entire people, saying that the calamities and shame Israel suffered entirely resulted from sins and evil. He earnestly prayed for God's forgiveness. Even though Daniel himself had no blemish in his deeds according to the law, on behalf of God's people and for God's name that had been defiled, he lamented and grieved. He earnestly prayed for Israel's restoration. His earnest, tearful prayer is recorded in the Bible. It goes as follows. O Lord, in accordance with all your righteous acts, let now your anger and your wrath turn away from your city, Jerusalem, your holy mountain. For because of our sins and iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and your people have become a reproach to all those around us. So now, Our God, listen to the prayer of your servant and to his supplications, and for your sake, O Lord, let your face shine on your desolate sanctuary. O my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolations and the city which is called by your name. For we are not presenting our supplications before you on account of our merits of our own, but on account of your great compassion. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, listen and take action. For your own sake, O my God, do not delay, because your city and your people are called by your name. I know that pastors are here as well in the sanctuary. Did you pray to God like this? Only then your true servants, as the souls left church, as the souls befriended the world, did you pray earnestly like that? Only then your true pastors are taking care of the souls. But whilst the souls, did you think, it's not my business? How, if you think so, how could you be true servant of God? You have to pray with tears and fasting, and you have to take responsibility. This is the true servants of God. But Father God will not call you servant. Even though you have the title of pastor, or you have nothing to do with God. All of you should become true servants. And just as Daniel prayed to God, and Father God was pleased with his prayer and blessed him, just as Father God answered his prayer, our pastors should have your prayer reach the Father God's throne like that, and offer a prayer, tearful prayer, and you have to receive prayer, pray to receive. As pastors, you have to. I know that you have the handkerchief, but you know, Mrs. Bong Nimne, as she prays with the handkerchief, healing works happen. Just like this, pastors, when you pray for people, there should be works happening. Pastor, I have this issue, I have this problem, please pray for me. And you have to go and pray for them. But, but no one asks you to do that because you have no power. If you have no such power, how could you be true pastors? But even church workers who have, you have to examine whether you have been a true servant or not. Whether you have prayed with tears, and you have to figure out why you could manifest power and works even after you, just because you get paid by the church, are you a servant? You have to lament over this situation and you have to. Pastors, you should become like this. So through our prayers, Father God will send the souls back to our church, and we can help them as we take care of them with love and embrace them with love. Pastor should kneel down. Pastors should examine themselves whether they kneel. I urge pastors to kneel down and pray. In his prayer, Daniel didn't rely on his or Israel's merits, but only on God's great compassion. He asked God to work for his glory and his holy name. While admitting that he and the people were not righteous, he asked that God work for his own sake. He earnestly asked him for mercy and forgiveness for Jerusalem, the city of God, and the people called by his name. Like this, after Daniel discovered God's promise, he didn't say, "I can just wait and see." Instead, he asked for God's answer in prayer and fasting on behalf of his people. Listening to his earnest prayer, God sent him Archangel Gabriel. He revealed to him how Jerusalem would be restored and how things would unfold in the end time. Father God must have been delighted by his prayer. And he even revealed to him what is to come in the end time. This is a great blessing. Father God had Daniel record what events in the end time. This indicates how pleased God was by his prayer. And Israel was restored according to God's promise. As spoken by prophet Jeremiah, after 70 years, during the reign of Cyrus, king of Persia, the restoration started off. The people had become captive, but the king told them to go back to their land. How could this be possible? They had already been held captive, but without a reason, the king sent them back and allowed them to rebuild their temple. How could this be possible? It's because it was under Father God's plan, and also there were people who, like Daniel, there were people of God who served as the passage and as the time came. Also, the Israelites humbled themselves and prayed to God. So Father God eventually fulfilled his providence. This is an absolute historical fact, which indicates how faithfully God fulfills his covenant. I also urge you to engrave in your heart this lesson, that even if God has said he will do it, receiving his answer requires us to hold on to his word and pray. You know, back in 1999 and 1998, and Father God said this trial is a blessing. And senior pastors said, asked us not to even use the word trial because this is a blessing. You know, some people lost their faith and judged the past judgment. And all these things turned into blessing
오직 아버지가 주신 대로 축복이다.
Just as Father God declared it was a blessing.
믿음으로 고백한 또 이들 일꾼들도 있었고.
There were church workers who asked Father God.
듣지 말라 하는데도 보고 들어서 나중에 또
There were people who repented.
복 못 받는 이들도 있는가 하면
Others only obeyed a word and stayed joyful and thankful and prayed. And as they saw the great works manifested by the shepherd, and they figure out the spiritual principles, what is that principle? When people of God suffers trouble, it is before they receive the blessing from God. As they figure out this spiritual principle and prayed, they receive blessing. That's what happened after the 1999 trial ended. If you have gone through that trial, you can remember what happened after that. We have great works of the shepherd, which is not possible by men. Seen a pastor suffer all kinds of trial that ordinary man cannot overcome, and people spread false rumors, and those people who received healing and received financial support were also tempted and passed judgment. There were people back in 1999, but senior pastor only held on to God and obeyed and dealt with them only in goodness and love. He didn't complain against anyone. He only sought God's will and only looked for the ways to please God. Like he conducted the divine healing meeting, and he also prayed in the sanctuary with us during the Daniel prayer meeting. And as a result, Father God turned the Muan Sui water. As we remember those events, we can apply this in this situation. We can. Which means Father God's promise is no longer effective. That's what people who left the church say. But still, we have Father God manifest works transcending space and time. Still, we have extraordinary rainbows. Father God is still working in that extraordinary way. So, why do people say the Father God's covenant and promise is no longer effective? This is not possible. Then, why Father God is guaranteeing us with His amazing works? But Father God's word is unchanging. And Father God, the shepherd's power is happening. So, there's no reason for us to have fleshly thoughts. Daniel was in a tough and so difficult situation. But when he discovered the word of God, which was spoken dozens of years ago by another prophet, he rejoiced and prayed. But what about us? The word was given to us, and we ourselves saw the shepherd's power. But why? We have to hold on to it. We shouldn't stop. How lamentable. You know, the word of God given to us, the promise of God, for the word of God to be fulfilled for sure, we have to ask with faith and unchangingly. And an important thing is we have to ask to the end with unchanging faith. Even while the situation is different, even while the situation seems to go the way opposite of the God's promise, we still have to ask. The Bible says, Therefore I say to you, all things for which you pray and ask, believe that you have received them, and they will be granted you. Holding on to this word, if we ask unceasingly until we receive His answer with faith, no matter what happens, no matter the situation, Even if the situation seems to go the opposite of what Father God said, we have to ask unceasingly until we receive His answer with faith that things will surely be fulfilled no matter the situation. And although there's no visible change and nothing has happened, God still tells us to pray without a change of heart. Then God will manifest His great work. Then, if you are without such faith, does this mean we have to give up? No. You need to pray and fast in order to possess such true, great, and spiritual faith. You have to say, Father God, I have no such faith. Please help me. Please help me have spiritual faith. Can you have spiritual faith just by praying? You have to cast off sins and evil to have spiritual faith. And this is how you prepare yourself. As you do so, you will find yourself without sin and evil and have spiritual faith. And then Father God will do His great works. After God promises to do things, some of His words are fulfilled right away, but others after quite a long time. It's because, depending on how great the answer we are going to receive, the size of the vessel we need to prepare on our part is different. The greater the answer is, the greater amount of prayer we need to offer. Also, the answer is given at the most appropriate time in God's sight. It was the case with Joseph. It took as long as 13 years for his God-given dream to be fulfilled. And it was 9 years after Joseph became the prime minister that his brothers knelt before him and reunited with his family. So it's a total of 22 years. Over those 13 years, he had hardship after hardship, where things went contrary to his God-given dream. At age 17, Joseph was sold by his brothers who hated him and began to live as a slave in the house of Potiphar. But, always conducting himself in a faithful and wise way, Joseph was recognized by his master and became the overseer over the house. But he suffered false charges and got imprisoned. From a physical perspective, things seemed to go well for a while, but soon he got into a deeper trouble. Although the situation seemed to go the way opposite to his God-given dream, Joseph believed that the dream would be fulfilled for sure. If Joseph hadn't had hope and faith, he could have given up in the middle and deviated from the right path. But Joseph believed that his God-given dream would be fulfilled and had faith of anticipating good days. So he stayed faithful in any circumstances, walking the right path. To this Joseph, God manifested the evidences of being with him, even amidst trials. God made Joseph successful wherever he went. When Joseph was serving in the house of Potiphar, the Bible says, the Lord was with Joseph, so he became a successful man. And he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. Now his master saw that the Lord was with him and how the Lord caused all that he had, all that he did to prosper in his hand. As Joseph became the overseer over the house, God blessed Potiphar's house, all that he owned, in the house and in the field. This resulted from Joseph's trusting in God, walking the right path, and acting faithfully. He believed in Father God's promise and stayed with God. Those who believe in God's promise, they don't do nothing. If you truly believe in His promise, you would pray and conduct yourself faithfully. And wherever you are, if you want to become the head, you would ask for wisdom and try to have more knowledge. As you
노력해서 얻는 결과 아닌가요? 세상 사람이 노력하는 것보다 우리는 적게도 더 많은
결과를 맺는 거죠. Even though we make comparison,
당연히 더 큰 결실을 얻게 하시는 거고.
Father God allows us to have greater fruit compared to our effort. If we think Father God will give us anyway, this is because you don't have faith. You have to examine whether you conduct yourself faithfully. Joseph's dream couldn't be fulfilled while Joseph just remained an overseer of the house of the captain of the bodyguard. Fulfilling the God-given dream required him to learn more things. So God led him according to his next plan. Joseph had a stable life in Potiphar's house, but God didn't let him be so in order to achieve the dream. Joseph suffered false charges brought by Potiphar's wife and was put in prison where king's prisoners were confined. From physical point of view, Joseph had no hope of reviving, restoration. He suffered false charges. How could resolve those wrong charges? He was confined in the prison where king's prisoners were locked up. Without Father God's intervention, he had no hope, no way of getting out of it. But Joseph only relied on God and did everything faithfully. And he did what is he did his best that he could. When he was locked up with the king's prisoners, he asked the king's officials to remember him. With the wisdom from Father God, he interpreted his fellow inmate's dream, and he asked. Things seemed to go bad. Joseph didn't get discouraged. Father God was with Joseph. The Bible says, "The Lord was with Joseph, so he became a successful man."
감옥을 다 다스리고 관리하는 사람이죠.
But the Lord was with Joseph and extended kindness to him and gave him favor in the sight of the chief jailer. The chief jailer committed to Joseph charge all the prisoners who were in the jail, so that whatever was done there, he was responsible for it. The chief jailer did not supervise anything under Joseph's charge because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made to prosper. If Joseph had looked at the reality from a physical perspective, he would have been frustrated with the situation going bad. From a physical viewpoint, things were seemingly going the way completely the opposite to his God-given dream. Like this, if Joseph had looked at the reality from a physical viewpoint, he must have complained without any hope. So what about pastors and church workers? Senior pastor is not here, and things have seemed to have become loose. But some people no longer work faithfully. That means they don't have faith. If you truly have faith, you wouldn't do so. With the dream of giving glory to God, more greatly, pastors should have that dream. All of you can have that. Anyone can go out and if you have true faith, if you're prepared, Father God allows you to go out. But because you don't have faith, you don't ask, and you become lazy and sluggish.
And
how Joseph, even though he had no hope, he thought of God and he believed in his God-given dream. That's how he conducted himself faithfully, and he had no complaints. That's how he stayed faithful even through those hardships. And what he learned during the trial, he could
자, 요셉은 하나님이 주신 꿈이 이루어질 것을 변함없이 믿었습니다.
Joseph kept unchanging faith in the God-given dream because he believed in it. He conducted himself faithfully in any situations and prayed for its fulfillment. Because Joseph viewed all things with the spiritual eyes of faith and hope, he always asked God. And as God was with Joseph, all that he did prospered. The Bible says, novice believers who lack spiritual understanding of the Bible, or those who lack spiritual faith, even though they've received God-given duties, may not figure out the part where Joseph went through trial. They may wonder, being in that hopeless situation, Joseph must have been discouraged, but why does the Bible say that he prospered? From a physical viewpoint, the situation was hopeless and bleak. But as we see the outcome, we can figure out why the Bible said he prospered even during the trials. Father God had planned great blessings for him. God planned to bless him tremendously, and Joseph underwent trials to fill up the measure of his justice. Because this was also under God's plan, he actually prospered. During those 13 years, painful 13 years, it was all under God's plan, and Joseph learned everything he needed to learn to fulfill God's covenant and to accomplish his will and providence of making a nation of Joseph's 12 sons. Joseph had to become a big vessel, which required a 13-year refining period. As the overseer over the house of Potiphar, a man of authority, he learned economy and culture. In the prison for king's prisoners, he learned politics and he learned how things go in the politics, and he understood the depths of man's heart. That's why in 13 years, even as he rose to the position of prime minister, the greatest one next to the king, he didn't lack wisdom and capability to save and rule the country. Father God, there is always a process when Father God guides us. Because of that, those 13 painful years, Joseph could learn all things that he had to learn as a prime minister. So Joseph didn't suffer any loss. He learned politics, he learned how things go, and he learned hearts of men. And he had his entire family settle in Egypt, preparing them to grow into a big nation. He acquired wisdom to do so. He also equipped himself with administrative skills to look after and help the neighboring countries. Most of all, he had his entire family settle in Egypt, preparing them to grow into a big nation. As Joseph was sold into slavery, served in Potiphar's house, and unfairly got prisoned, he learned and acquired many things and became an outstanding prime minister. So everything was under God's plan, and Joseph prospered all through the process. And what about you? Well, senior pastor is now with us. What did you do? What did you accomplish? And what did you change about yourself? The most important thing is, Father God, you have to be thankful that Father God is still with us. And you must have realized, without the shepherd, you cannot change yourself. Without the word, you cannot. You must have felt it more deeply. And you must have discovered the roots of evil in you. And you must have realized how important it is to cleanse yourself. It seemed like you, but while senior pastor is away, those evil and sins sprang up. Like, you must have discovered yourself in those ways. If you have discovered them, you have to, you shouldn't say, when Sina pastor is back, I will do my best. And those people, even though Father God's, the time for Father God's blessing come, they cannot share in those. Some of you may say, oh, when Sina pastor is back, I can work hard and with the fullness of the Spirit. That's the same when back in the 1999, those people who stayed faithful and worked hard unchangingly, they shared in the blessing we all received. But those people who passed judgment and wavered here and there, they couldn't receive the blessing. They had to repent thoroughly. Some of them repented thoroughly, repented of their doubts, repented of having passed judgment, repented of hearing and seeing what they must not see and hear. There were people who changed themselves after repentance. And there were others who didn't change after repentance. And they, as they went through this trial, they, when Father God's time arrives, that's why we have to be prepared now. We have to turn from our ways. We have to repent. We shouldn't say, when Sina pastor is back, we have to become the good fruit of the shepherd. Only then Father God will achieve good works through you. You have to check whether what you have been doing. You know, Joseph held on to Father God's promise and overcame all his trials and worked faithfully, preparing his vessels. That's why Father God exalted him. And when Father God exalted him, he lacked nothing. So now you have to make yourself like this. If God is with us, even though our physical situation looks bad, we are prospering spiritually. But don't be mistaken. Trials or retributions caused by your sins differ from Joseph's trials. But even in trials caused by sins, if you repent from your heart and endure them in joy and thanksgiving, this is a blessing. It's because you become perfectly forgiven and change all the more. Thus, as we encounter a situation, if we first look back on ourselves and do what pleases God in joy and thanksgiving, our God of love makes us the most beautiful ones. Considering Joseph's trials, we find that Father God makes us prosper and leads His beloved children onto the most blessed path. Joseph believed in his God-given dream and his promise. Even when he faced situations looking like the complete opposite of that dream, he believed in God and prayed, walking the right path. In other words, he spent as long as 13 years in great hardships and trials, but he held on to that dream without wavering at all and asked God. That's how he could fulfill the dream. Like this, if you hold on to the God-given dream with unchanging faith, pray and demonstrate God-pleasing obedience, God will surely do it. Hopefully, all mommy members will receive His answers and blessings through prayer and deeds of faith. Starting tomorrow, we will have the 21-day vow prayer meeting and fasting relay. Just like Daniel, who fasted and prayed holding on to God's covenant, I ask you to earnestly ask with faith and love. You know, Daniel held on to Father God. As a result, he saw and I ask you to earnestly ask Father God, who will do what He has promised to Manmin and will be glorified through Manmin. By keeping in mind God's word, I will do it, but they have to ask. I pray that you will offer a prayer of faith so that God's great glory will be revealed through my men, the shepherd, and yourselves. Let's reflect on today's message in our prayer. It's time to receive the prayer for the sick. If you are sick, lay your hands on the sick part. If you are not sick, lay your hands on your chest and receive the prayer with your heart's desire. Hallelujah, Almighty God, our loving Father, please lay your hands on all believers who are receiving this prayer now. Show your works that transcend time and space on those who are receiving this prayer through GCN, internet, and satellite TV, in branch churches and local sanctuaries, and all other children of God around the world. Give them the faith and to believe from heart, drive away negative thoughts and doubts, and drive away all tests and trials. From head to toe, all entrails and joints and nerves and tissues and cells, whatever the sick part may be, burn them with the fire of the Holy Spirit and the original light. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command the enemy, devil, and Satan, all diseases, germs, and viruses and infirmities go away, light come. Please scourge all their terminal and incurable diseases with the fire of the Holy Spirit. Drive away all endemic diseases, including malaria. All contagious diseases, including cold, flu, and fever, go away. Protect them from all kinds of germs and viruses. Heal them of all stomach, lung, liver, breast, uterine, and intestinal cancers, AIDS, leukemia, cerebral apoplexy, high low blood pressure, diabetes, thyroid problems, and heart, lung, and women's diseases, and all inflammations go away. Heal them of polio, stroke, arthritis, and herniated discs, back pain, headache, and neuralgia, and all other pains disappear. Epilepsy, autism, depression, neurosis, and other mental diseases go away. All kinds of paralysis be loosened, get up, walk, and leap. Let the eyes see well, let the ears heal well. Let the blind come to see, the deaf to hear, and the mute to speak. Heal them of after effects of all kinds of accidents. Fix their broken bones. Restore them from burns. Let the heat and burning sensation go away. Father, let there be no scar left. Be cleansed from all kinds of drug addictions, poisoning, and substance abuse. Let the dead nerves and tissues and cells be regenerated. Bring the dead back to life. Give them the blessing of conception. Receive the blessing of conception. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command the enemy, devil, and Satan, the ruler of the power of the air, and the evil forces of heavenly places and their servants, go away. Go away, evil, unclean, false and deceitful spirits, and separating spirits, and all forces of darkness. Loosen the bonds of wickedness. Darkness, go away. Light, come. Father God, give them strength to cry out in prayer and the power to cast off sins and become sanctified. As their souls prosper, let all things go well with them and let their families be evangelized. Protect them from all kinds of accidents and disasters throughout this week and bless them to lead a prosperous life without any problems. With the fiery walls of the Holy Spirit, heavenly hosts and angels, and with your blazing eyes, protect all your children, their families, workplaces, and business fields. Give students wisdom and understanding, and give them enthusiasm and fervor to study hard. Please keep their hearts and minds from worldly things, and let them love God more fervently. Whether your children eat or drink, or in whatever they do, let them do it all to live a life glorifying you, Father God. Let him be able to testify about the living God, saying, I've met and experienced God and received his answers and blessings. Father God, thank you. Be glorified alone. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.